Axe water, our real use for cleanse Jamaica. Yeah, man, burn the fire, keep the water boiling. Yes, I like the new water though. Just checking over the sun and wants a purification. Yes, sir.
Turn truck in my no tank here, so. Let my police and be a like a police, no sir. Don't drag him and no thank you. Oh, Tada.
Continuum Global Solution is seeking call center personnel to fill vacant positions. Company drop here at the Virgin Baptist Church, Market Street, Montego on Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday.
I see him, so then pull out J-out at J-O's, because then go in at J-O's,
one search J-O's. You can also call or WhatsApp 876-278-5045. 876-278-5045.
For a fresh interview, Continuum Global Solution is offering a chance to raise $500.
Incident some time back with an individual that was being arrested by the police, and he put up some resistance. And in response to that incident, one Corporal Rowan James, at the time, that's what his rank was advocating for life sentence for people resisting arrest, right? Now, this is Corporal James. As I said, at the time, he was Corporal James.
We must send the strongest signal in this country that law enforcement in this country means a lot. It is the buffer between those who decide that they are going to break the law and cause our society to be in mayhem, and for us not to be achieving our full potential as a nation. And
no, your man come out strong. We should send a strong message, and he's advocating for life sentence for resisting arrest. Now, there's a saying that the punishment should fit the crime. I don't think that's the approach that he's taking. Seems very authoritarian, dictatorship-like, and it seems like he's on one side of the fence, and he's advocating for, like he's at war with the other side, advocating for severity on the other side. What I'd like to see is a balanced approach where you can also say, likewise, we need to send a strong message to law enforcement that they need to respect the rights of civilians, that they need to adhere and follow the law, follow the policies and procedures and proper protocol. And likewise, I would love for you to have given a statement as to what you recommend and what the minimum penalty should be for an officer that engages in an unlawful arrest and falls imprisonment. So that's my question to you. What do you recommend? Like, you recommend life sentence for resisting arrest. What do you recommend as the minimum sentence for an officer who engages in false imprisonment and an unlawful arrest? What is your recommendation? I'm curious. Please, if you don't mind, please indulge us. Because on a regular basis, you have officers engaging in unlawful conduct. I personally have had two experiences where police in Pomer, one a Waterford, one a 100 man, let me know that if them so decide, them can go lock me up. Them not a crime, them not offenses. What them suspect me of committing. One thing we can just say, oh, I match the description of a suspect that they're looking for, right, that has a warrant out for them. And them can hold me for 72 hours. That's the one from Waterford. The next one from 100 Man say, them can hold me for up to, slap me up, hold me for up to 72 hours. And whether illegal or not, that's something I've got to take up with the government, not his concern. Yeah? So please, I'm curious to find out what would be the minimum punishment or penalty that you recommend for such unlawful actions by law enforcement. You come out strong on one side, kind of show bias. Come out strong on the other side, now for sure say, oh, you're neutral on your fear. Tell me, what would you recommend? I have a simple suggestion which I believe will cause major improvement in the force. Currently, JC have a policy that stipulates that they should identify themselves whenever they interact with members of the public. That's the policy. But the reality is, a lot of JCF members don't do that. They have approaches ranging from covering them face with ski mask or scarf, hiding them name and regulation number with vest or scarves, removing them name or regulation number from the uniform. If you ask them then to let they'll give it to you after the interaction, and they don't. And then I believe they're supposed to give it to you at the beginning based on what the policy say. But them still don't get it at the end with them saying what, so they want to give it to you. Or them have a little style with them say them give it to you and you don't hear. Yeah? That's the play. So now them can claim to say, oh, I thought I gave it to him already. Or I gave it to him already, but him never hear. You know? Setting up a defense in anticipation if you actually do find out who they are. So that is the practice and that is the reality. If that is the practice and the reality, I find it difficult to believe that the superiors are not aware of that. Which would mean one of two things. You guys are not supervising your officers or monitoring what they're doing properly to identify and confirm that they are acting accordingly and summit them, do whatever them feel like. And when a situation arises and address it, not proactive. When you're supposed to actively monitor the individuals and see how them operate and carry themselves to make sure they are in accordance. But on top of that, you're supposed to have serious reprimands and consequences for individuals who don't identify themselves. That should be one of the most serious offenses a member of the JCF could commit, because essential to interacting with civilians and gaining the cooperation of civilians is for the civilian to clearly identify you as a law enforcement officer. And a part of that should include you clearly identifying yourself and who you are. You see me? That should come right under that section where you are required to clearly identify yourself as a law enforcement personnel whenever it is that you're interacting with the public. That should come right under there, so. That should be a very serious offense. Because imagine a man who don't identify himself, all of the wrongs that he can do, whether intentionally or unintentionally, and there'll be no way to hold him accountable. And the minister says, they are not willing to furnish the identifying information for police officers because they're entitled to privacy in the information, even though the policy stipulates that they have their information on display for the public to see and that they furnish it to the public. And there's actually an act, at least the Prohibited Weapons Act, that stipulates that information be furnished to members of the public. But yet the ministry would rather protect that information that's supposed to be public information. What exactly are you trying to accomplish with that approach? What exactly? I probe similar stance. They won't furnish that information. Go as far as to say there's no legal obligation. I guess the members of I probe haven't read the Prohibited Weapons Act to see that there is a legal obligation to identify. It's not just a policy. So the point I'm trying to make is, and before we go there, so think about the situation. If you call a customer service line, one of the first things that the customer service representative will provide you with before even asking you what's your issue is their name. Thank you for calling such and such. My name is such and such. How may I assist you today? Very important. Whenever you're interacting with anybody, especially someone who don't know you, you communicate who you are. Hi, my name is such and such from such and such. Today we're interacting with you because of such and such or whatever the case may be. It ain't hard. Ain't hard to do. Kind of make me feel like the people, them, the police officers, them who refuse to identify themselves, know say yo, them are both for do something wrong. They know them the professional. And that's the easiest way to avoid accountability. The person don't know your name, them can't report you. And superiors don't seem to be very concerned about the fact that the police now furnish them information properly to the public. And I feel very confident that if you address that and get them to furnish them name, at least some of them who are not so brazen will stop the foolishness they want to do, knowing very well that they can now be held accountable. Some of them now don't care still, but then you deal with those at a different level. But at least lessen the pool of bad cops or unprofessional cops or unprofessional police conduct, rather, by simply putting more adverse punishments or reprimands, rather, for failing to identify yourself properly. Address that, and I believe you'll be able to easily address half of the complaints you have with police. Some of them are just going to disappear because police are gone. Depending on him best behavior, knowing that you have him information, and the rest, you're going to be able to easily identify the police officer and address them about their unprofessional conduct. Half of that solve. Jamaica have a lot more professional cops out there to deal with, and then we can now focus on the ones that are, you know, going really deep into the foolishness. Try it. Take my stupid advice and try it and see how it works.